Thank you very much, Michael. Thank you very much for coming. I don't know if I will contradict you a little bit in terms of scaring. We will see anyway. What I'm talking to you about tonight is spam, actually, and I will explain, or try to explain why I define it the economy of desire. Spam, as one of the inescapable communication phenomena of our times, is a lively part of our infoscape. Spam is extremely pervasive. For billions of persons whose personal communication door is easy to spot and trade, from the advertisement of extraordinary products to the so-called phishing, the spam entrepreneur knows almost perfectly how to verbally titillate his target. So spam, it's not only about abusing a common, the communication space and protocols, but mainly it's about constantly reinventing the conscious language of goods charm and the endless literary war between anti-spam guards and spammers will probably never have a winner. It will be played using different code sign combinations to trick new filters and go through the verbal protection and censorship. With a constant readiness overload, few strategic keywords can make the difference. I would like to start then with the quote attributed to Eric Fromm. He said, "A vast sector of modern advertising does not appeal to reason, but to emotion. Like any other kind of hypnotic suggestion, it tries to impress its objects emotionally and then make them submit intellectually. We have to assume that during the last century, we've formidably increased the amount of content that we swallow every day. As early as in 1985, Theodore Roszak noted in his book, The Cult of Information, that a weekday edition of the New York Times contains more information than the average person was likely to come across in a lifetime in 17th century England. That was before the internet. Today, with the ocean of available knowledge floating around us, the scenario is dramatically changing. According to a University of California San Diego study, the average American consumes 34 gigabytes worth of content a day, including a massive 100,000 words of information. The researchers make it clear that we don't necessarily parse a full 100,000 words per day, but that astonishing figure does cross our eyes and ears each 24 hours interval via multiple channels, web, TV, text messaging, radio, video games, and more, of course. The process of targeting the individual was massively applied at the end of the 70s through the direct marketing practices. Personally, I've received the first physical bulk mail in the middle of the 80s when I was 15. In the form of a very customized promotional letter. The letter was establishing for the first time a different seller-customer relationship, not anymore anonymous. If you think these concepts are from the 80s, think again, because the DMA, the Direct Marketing Association, was founded in the United States in 1917. What the postal direct marketing announced was the personal space invasion. John Thackera, the director of the Doors of Perception conference, said that our dilemma is not that we receive too much information. We don't receive anywhere near the quantity of data it takes to overload our neurons. Our minds are capable of processing and analyzing many gigabits of data per second, a lot more data than any of today's supercomputers can process and act on in real time. We feel flooded because we are getting information unfiltered, unsorted, and unframed. We lack ways to see what's important. In fact, we are not yet trained to avoid unwanted information. In a textual environment, as spam is, we are still overcome by our primary instinct of being attracted by signs and so by words. So we lose reference points and filters, proper framing, and even more important, time to ponder, to let the content settle. In a word, we lose more and more the ability to be critic. The concept of unsolicited commercial proposal of advertisement delivered to your own door probably dates back to the first traveling salesman at the end of the 19th century. At that time, salesmen toured the countryside trying to sell their goods directly to the doors of their potential customers without any previous appointment. But probably the first time of mediated unsolicited advertisement delivered at home through physical mail is the printed one, and then the so-called telemarketing, sales proposals made through the telephone, both still, unfortunately, widely used today. The first evolution of these strategies at the end of the 80s was that many advertisements were arbitrarily sent by fax, causing harsh reactions for the huge amount of wasted thermal paper involved. The sending of non-solicited email dates back to the first mail of 1978, when the marketing department of DEC, the famous computer manufacturer, invited his users to assist to the DEC System 20 new models presentation in Los Angeles. The word spam, that there is from the infamous canned meats firm, was used in the 80s in the BBS scene and in the chat communities as a repetitive visual sounding noise for driving out unwelcome guests. It was clearly referring to a popular Monty Python sketch first broadcasted on December 15, 1917, and then often rebroadcasted on the BBC. It was the final sketch of the 20th show of the Monty Python's Flying Circus, and it was very popular among computer enthusiasts. Let's see this show.
Victory was at the Green Midget Cafe in Bromley. Once again, the Viking strategy was the same. They sailed from these fjords here, assembled at Trondheim, and waited for the strong northeasterly winds to blow their oaken galleys to England, whence they sailed on May the 23rd. Once in Bromley, they assembled in the Green Midget Cafe and and spam, selecting a spam particular spam item from the spam menu, would spam, 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 spam,
engineering, characterized by attempts to fraudulently acquire money or sensitive information such as passwords, masquerading as a trustworthy person or business. The scam messages are usually very carefully written, and they sometimes get what they want, the trust of the deceived person. In fact, as the famous hacker Kevin Mitnick says in his book, The Art of Deception, trust is the key to deception. It's a dangerous communication game, and it's all about the used codes. So mimicking the official tones, using conventions, national prejudices, myths, and rumors can cause people to lose variable amounts of money as a result of the trust in some email messages. The scam evokes a daydream, the dream of being rich or sexually irresistible, or being admired for wearing an expensive clock. Most of scams are clearly based on the desire of a once-in-a-life opportunity. And with the internet, nobody is stuck on his physical place. The opportunities can emerge from anywhere in the network. So the internet cornucopia can bring that long-awaited opportunity. A very basic taxonomy of spam sent for phishing seem to be based on two main concepts, fear and fortune. Fear is about technology gone wrong. So a bank account or a PayPal account verification, violation, or even worse, termination. Or a typical spam subject, thanks for changing your password, but you actually never changed your password. Or wrong credit card charges for never purchased goods. One typical is your flight ticket online, but you never bought it. The other concept is fortune, unexpected money, becoming rich overnight. There are a few strategies about that. One, it's hot stocks, suggested stocks that would rocket their value overnight or in a few days. The other one is lottery winning. Congratulations, you won the lottery. I'm usually referred about winning the Spanish and the Irish lottery. I don't know why. The other one is mistaken identity for big inheritance. So there's apparently a relative of yours with the same second name that has an heritage of a few million dollars, and there's somebody contact you, typically a lawyer, saying, we have to transfer this money, please give us your bank account details. Or the so-called Nigerian scam, probably the most famous one, the request to transit huge amount of money for a percentage. When dealing with spam, the feelings of powerlessness are always balancing the will to revenge. And there's an artwork, The Spam Shredder by Bill Shackelford, that is a self-sufficient installation that executes spam in public. Here is a short video of this installation. The most recent version was sponsored by Cisco. But among the most recent spam techniques, there's the inclusion in the message of some so-called inauthentic text. It's the one at the bottom. Inauthentic text is an automatically generated and grammatically correct nonsense that spammers use on top of their email to effectively trick spam filters. Spamland is a series of three movies produced by the brothers MacLeod using as scripts this almost surreal, inauthentic text. I will show you the second of the three movies realized by the brothers MacLeod.
In a gravitation without warning, the face of Rubbing grew
sullen, black, angry mouths.
The clouds swallowed up with horsehair. The air was religion with suppressed excitement. The walk howled through the solidness and sobbed, and calfskin and the secret of the desperado. The chime of the threads bell flowed out into the jawline. The course notes the holy chant Thursday with a storm, like refreshingly angels with Satan. At last, the likenesses of investments lay vanquished. The composure paused in its course to do careening to God. Jehovah, however, an abruptness clap of thunder smote the sky. The lame chime of the prince off with a cradle dissonance. Demons seemed the brethren. Breastworks chilling with gleaming eyes and trembling acidly the militant army of God swept. Up, unchaste stairs mumbling the ritual of the Percy. Infected boatswain by the matching hysteria. Aubrey, open air of the 50-pound, unearthly noises like an incorrect parody of the holy sand that marks the elevation of the backward alarmed. The ears, the octave monks, unspeakable blasphemies, streak with two drop-off. Rain came down. Delicatessen cataract napkins of lightning chased one comp like battling fiery dragons. Freak jangled, hideously out of urgent cheaper, and pressed experiment. The Caravaggio threw issues more than latently, and rubbed, both notched.
So when it comes to inauthentic texts, spam has mutated till digesting its own junk element to survive and escape the evolving spam filter's artificial intelligence. In spamland movies, its illogical sequence is finally translated into movie scripts, and the MacLeod skills are able to almost completely exploit text's involuntary poetic form, producing elegant animations and intrinsically derailed characters. So if spam is going to be quickly and sometimes obscurely digested, we should wonder, in this form and at this rate of information speed, how far we are from a standard and authorized subliminal transmission of information. For those not familiar with the concept, subliminal stimuli are sensory stimulation below an individual's absolute threshold for conscious perception. And they have been introduced in the 50s when marketing practitioners claimed their potential use in persuasion, although studies prove that their effect is a mild one. The question is, are we adapting to swallow chunks of information in an almost subliminal way? In the 1985 film Max Headroom, 20 Minutes into the Future, there's an example of commercial subliminal communication served too fast. Let me show you this cut from the movie.
Bryce, I understand you have some information regarding your Blipbert project, which might help explain the unfortunate accident in apartment 142 Zeta.
I have a classified Rebus tape which recorded the incident during a routine two-way sampler at the time. It is a bit graphic, I'm afraid.
Is there any way to explain this side effect?
Oh, yes, it is rare but explicable. See, the human body has millions of nerve endings. Each carries an electrical charge. Individually very tiny, but in combination, surprisingly large. Now, normal people just burn this off in exercise, but in inactive people, it sort of builds up. Now, because I designed blipvertisements to compress a 30-second advertisement into 3 seconds, it seems that the brain violently stimulates all of these nerve endings simultaneously. In some viewers, this seems to cause a short circuit throughout the body. In some particularly slothful, perpetual viewers literally explode. Pretty simple, really.
Pretty simple. Here there was a commercial, there was a new media beast, the blipverts. The blipverts were high-speed, concentrated, high-intensity television commercials lasting about 5 seconds. Their purpose was to prevent channel switching during standard length commercials. But in this movie, blipverts are also a lethal side effect, as you've seen. People are literally exploding when exposed to blipverts. Although we are probably not going to explode, we are unquestionably affected by this progressive and seemingly unstoppable accelerated overload of information. And being fast and overloading are two of the peculiarities of spam. So finally, we will never definitely stop the overload of information or get used to it. Spam is open access reverse engineering. And becoming the testbed for the next generation of marketing, if Eric Fromm was right, one of the basic human needs is to feel new emotions. And spam is full of fake of them. So bringing virtual hope, desire, and happiness. Spam should be an excellent model for some of the near future mass media communication. And if invasive advertisement is going to slowly become the norm, we will probably adapt to it through our own language skills in order to avoid it at any level or indulge on it now or in its future more subtle and sophisticated incarnations. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you for that wonderful speech. You can stay here for a second, and we'll do some questions from the audience. And I'd like to open the Q&A with a question on, you spoke about the size of the economy in one of your slides, like how much you can actually earn doing spam. So there's plenty of sellers making a lot of money. Apparently, 1 in a million consumers. But who are these people that buy and sell through spam? Like, what is their profile? Where are they situated? Or are they just a random
pick? You mean who are the spammers?
Who are the spammers, but also who are the consumers?
Well, the consumers is potentially anybody. There's no consumer profiles, but there are some quite sad things, like if you read this spammer's book, this book wrote by a spammer, you would see that, for example, for people who is first buying accounts for playing to online casino, then they are proposed to buy online mortgages. So they know that they will lose money. And after a while, they propose them to recover their money through mortgages, so they know their target in a way. Who are they? Usually, they are young people, as far as it has been investigated, that are very comfortable with technology, and so they can do this. Usually, they don't do for a long time, also because it's technically difficult, because they are shut off most of the time. Their servers are closed. There's this continuous sort of game between the spam guards, people who has to block the spam, and the spammers inventing new tricks to pass the filters. There's this scenario, more or less.
Yeah, about this evolution of spam getting more intelligent, filters getting more intelligent, and this battle. What is your prediction for the future in that? Is that something that will go on eternally?
I don't know. I actually am not good in predicting future, but what I'm observing is that the concept of spam is being accepted slowly, culturally in society. So when you get the spam in Facebook, you recognize it, and you are not upset as you did in email. And when you get spam in Skype, in Skype, it's the same. So we are getting used to it. So I don't know if the spam in his email incarnation will go on forever. Probably there will be other type of incarnations. But the thing I'm most concerned about is that slowly we are accepting it. And if I can make a parallel with the very beginning of internet, in the very beginning of internet, on the news group, on the Usenet news groups, commercials were simply not allowed. You couldn't post anything. Even a press release of this event would have been considered blasphemy. Now the situation is completely different. It's 15 years later. But that should tell us something about how we should look about the future.
Okay. Are there any questions in the audience? Wilco, can you get a microphone over there?
In the Netherlands, there is this anti-spam law now. So you can really notice in your mailbox. Are you aware of new developments that are actively trying to circumvent these anti-spam laws?
Actually, it's a very... The border is usually blurred, I would say, because how can you define a spam message? I mean, the one I've talked about are really immediately recognizable as a spam messages. Your bank account has been violated in subject. But any unwanted email probably can be considered as a spam. So the border is... force filters is recognizing that message is not wanted. But it's really tricky. It's something that you have to instruct a machine to do. Strategies are basically focused on pretend to be human and not spammers. So varying the messages a lot and being as much as possible customized for the recipient. And if they will succeed, it will be very difficult then to stop them automatically. But to say the whole truth, actually, there are many spam filters that are working quite well, basing on an extensive dictionary of terms used in spam messages built on the computer, on the user's machine. So there are strategies that are effective, but this border is a blurred one. So there's a lot of space for spammers if they want to.
Okay. There was another question back there. Yeah.
Thank you. I think we all agree on the fact that spam finds the back orifice of our desires. But don't you think it's to advertising what is the brute force for computing? And so I wonder if the next step in terms of stealth persuasion, wouldn't be something like the reverse, reverted spam that would be maps. It's about mapping the desire, mapping the brain, the maps of the brain. And I think the transparency created by organizations like, or companies like Google, that knows everything about what we say, what we do, who we love, what we like, and everything. This full transparency is creating something more specific and with a granularity that is so accurate that instead of sending 1 million of spam to get one answer, just send one because they know your desire, because they know exactly what you want. So this is not, the problem won't be the unsolicited message, but the problem will be probably the very solicited message. But that we didn't want to receive.
Yeah, you mean we won't need spam anymore if they know everything about us?
No. I don't say we won't need. I have the feeling that spam is an age, an era, in terms of persuasion. And now the next step is probably understanding better what people have in their brain. And instead of us sending 1 million messages, we send one to the right person at the right time.
Yeah, no.
And this is what I call maps.
I got
the reverse spam, you know, spam.
Yeah,
maps.
Yeah. Actually, I would say that. You are right in terms that this marketing techniques of, I don't know the English word, but was like shooting in a mass to pick up a few people. So sending 1 million, sending 1 million messages to have a few hundred sales. It's an old concept, you are right in that. And transparency, as we are experiencing it now, most of it even voluntary, that's one of the frightening aspects for me, is making this strategy a little bit old. But still, even if Google should know everything about me and even my tastes and my desires, if Google want to trigger a sale through on me, they have to trigger it somehow, so they have to spam a little bit. So instead of sending 1 millionth email, the scenario should be of sending 1 million very customized email for triggering sales. That for me is even more frightening than the previous model.
So I think you both agree, actually.
Yeah.
One more question also to round this Q&A off. We've been talking about spam as a more commercially persuasive tool. But why has spam never been successful as a political persuasive tool?
Because it's spam. The main thing about spam is that it doesn't care who you are, even if it poses as a friend of you. So politically, I want to be considered a person that is part of a movement. Politically, I want to be involved and engaged as an active person that is recognized. If you use this kind of strategies to involve people, people would just feel to be involved as anonymous agents, not as persons. And this is a very important distinction. Being involved as being recognized as a person that is relating to this transparency we are facing, and being just a target.
Okay, thank you. If there's no more urgent questions, then I'd like to thank Alessandro.
Thank you very much.